getting to know you, getting to know all about you, getting to like you, getting to like you like me too, getting to know you, putting it my way, but nicely, as well as you nice. You are precisely my cup of tea. Yes, you are. Getting to know you. Getting to feel free and easy. I ain't easy. Are you easy? I ain't easy. When I am with you, getting to know what to say. I always know what to say. You know that. Haven't you noticed? Suddenly, I'm right and breathing. Oh, well, I'll open the window. Because of all these beautiful and new things I'm learning about you day by day.
Hello, 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 and welcome to an episode of Getting to Know the Weirdos. And today I've got with me Quinten. Hello, Quinten. How are you?
I'm doing good. How are you doing?
Not bad. Not bad at all. So, Quinten, you've been hanging around my channel, what, about a year or so now?
I believe so. I think it's a year, more than a year. But
might be more than a year. It might even be 2 years. It's been a while. So, but how did you find the channel in the first place?
How do I find a channel? I believe I got this channel from a friend from TJ. If I'm not mistaken, a friend from TJ goes by the name Vincent. He's little chit chats about here and there. Then all of a sudden, there's a couple of a list of folks pop up. And then first, I got to know TJ, and then from TJ, I got to know from you. So, some few connections.
Well, that's strange, because Vincent came to my channel, which is why TJ found Vincent. How weird is that?
It's a small world.
I believe that's what happened. Anyway, TJ will probably correct me and tell me I'm wrong. But I'm pretty sure Vincent was in my channel. Oh, no, it might have been. Might have been Vincent found my channel through TJ, but I'm not sure now. But, yeah, I remember him coming into my chats a few times, but he hasn't been around for a long time. But I do remember Vincent. I think he even came up on panel once.
Oh, really?
So, let's get to know Quinten. So, you've got your name as Q Continuum here at the moment. Is what's the story behind that? Is that
true? The story that I got from Q Continuum was from Pop's Fan's dad, and he told me quite a while ago that where does the Q Continuum comes from, and from that on, I simply did a Google's research who it is or what it is. At first, I thought it was a made up nickname. It turned out that the Q Continuum comes from the characters from Star Trek The Next Generation.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. I've heard of the Q Continuum. So that's what it's about. It's Star Trek. But you didn't know. Someone just gave you that nickname. You didn't know it was about.
Yes.
So you went and researched it. Cool. Yeah.
It's cool.
Yeah. They're like, are they? They're not a Borg state, are they? But they're all under the same mind. Is that right?
The Q Continuum was actually from it's from Star Trek, but it's not really a Borgish type of but it's more of a being, more of an omniscient being that pops in and pops out, started as an ongoing bad guy, then later on it goes went from bad guy to an anti-villain or anti-hero type. Basically, he's on a so-so level.
It's a long time since I watched Star Trek, to be fair. And I do remember vaguely remember the Q continuum. So it's just a nickname someone gave you and you've decided to go with it.
Yep.
Awesome.
I go with it, you
know. So, I don't know if you want to talk about where you come from and stuff like that. I think you've been pretty open about that. So
I'm pretty open.
Yeah. So you're from Holland, is that right?
And let's just say in a civil way, yes, it's true. But I wasn't actually born in the Netherlands. In reality, I was born in a small island in the Dutch kingdom called Curaçao, which is located between Aruba and Bonaire. It's in the Caribbean islands on the coast of Venezuela.
Awesome.
Born there, I grew up there, and by 2010, I educated in the States for only 1 year, and then after a few years or so, I mean, after 1 year, flew back to the island itself, and then just a couple of years later, I came here in the Netherlands, and so far, I've been living here for more than 10 years.
Too long?
Too long indeed, but it is fun though.
Do you ever wish you were back on the island?
Occasionally, from time to time, I used to fly into the island during the holidays. That's to simply say, during the best part would be on the Christmas holiday, because a lot of folks didn't like the cold, so they prefer to fly to the Caribbean for a nice, warm, tropical weather.
So you disappear at Christmas to go to the hot weather. Is that what you're saying?
Usually. Usually, yeah.
So you don't like Christmas with snow around you?
I do like it sometimes. I mean, don't get me wrong, there's any type of a season, it can be cold or rain. But here in the Netherlands, on the other hand, they rarely snowed. And during the winter, all I've seen the last year or so, all I've seen is mostly rain, then wind, then hail, then some few showers here and there, almost a reminiscence of the Blade Runner type. But when it comes to snow, the only snow we do experience is only wet snow.
Yeah. Yeah, pretty much same here. I mean, very rarely we get snow that settles, and everyone makes a big fuss about it, like it's a miracle or a nightmare, one or the other, depending on whether you like the snow or not. But yeah, no. And that's most of Europe, unless you're really in the mountains, don't really get a lot of snow. As far as I'm aware, obviously Scandinavia does.
Which is mostly part of Europe. In the interior. Mm-hmm. Or if you go further, let's just say if you're further inland, let's just say in the Alps, in the region of the Alps, or in as far as Poland or so, more and further inland, then you get more snow.
Yeah. So if you're heading if you're heading towards Russia, which is where your Poland is, you're heading towards Russia, you get your snow. But then again, that's north. You've got to remember that's north. And the Alps, obviously, is your mountain. So like I said, if you're heading towards the mountains, you'll get snow. Head north, you'll get snow. But mainland Europe, it's not a huge amount of snow. I'm not, obviously, the UK is not mainland Europe, but it's on that same sort of like bound of the planet, if you like. But yeah, Poland, you're going up north, you're in line with Scandinavia and Russia, then yeah, you'll get the snow. But yeah, so I mean, my family's from Holland, but I've never been there. How bad is that? Do you believe it's literally across the road from me? If you think of it on the world, it's just there, and I've never been.
Just a stone throw away. The only thing you simply cross over is just cross the English Channel. Say, Hey.
I've been to France, I've been to Italy, I've been to Spain, never been to Holland. Or Netherlands, sorry.
Never.
Never. I will do one day.
You wish you could visit there.
I will do one day. I should do sooner rather than later because otherwise the family I've got there won't be there, if that makes sense.
True that.
So I mean I've got great aunts and uncles over there. But they're getting old now. They have to be getting old because I'm getting old and they're older than me. If I don't visit at some point, because I've met them, I've met a couple of them, but I haven't met all of them because they came over to us when I haven't seen them since I was a kid, keep in contact with my cousins or second cousins because they're not my cousins, they're my dad's cousins. Via Facebook, but that's it. Really don't have any contact with them. And I think only one of my sisters has actually been over to visit them in all these years, which is, yeah. So tell us a little bit more about yourself. What
Alrighty.
yeah, go on.
I don't know where I'd begin, but
Let's start simple. What's your favorite color?
well, my favorite color is mostly blue. All the shades of blue that I like, but due to the two types of blue that I like, it's the cerulean blue, which you mostly find up in the air or in the bottom of the not really deep, deep bottom of the ocean. But that's my favorite color, blue, and the other one would be the green. If I'm not mistaken, yep, green is my one of my favorite colors too, also.
Okay. And what do you like doing? What's your favorite? What's your hobbies?
My hobby is mostly drawing, as you've seen in my avatar, and not only that, drawing, painting, and when it comes to daily activities, I simply. Mostly, I like swimming in the ocean or in the, or sometimes mostly I like in the ocean swimming.
Cool. So, and obviously, you like swimming in tropical oceans. You'd rather go swimming in the Caribbean than on the coast of Holland, yeah?
Yes.
Yes. Yes. So.
And when it comes to also drawing and stuff, it can be many types of styles of drawing, whether it's in either on mural or on canvas or on paper,
Okay.
things like that.
So you just do that as a hobby, or are you trying to make a living out of it? Do you make a living out of it?
I do mostly in hobby, and when it comes to a job, on the other hand, I used to do many different types of a day job.
Okay. So it's just an escapism you are. Cool. Cool. So what sort of things do you like drawing?
And it goes a long way. I mean, I started drawing as any particular animals. Because it happens when I was a kid, when I was when I was let's just say 6 or so years old, I mostly visited my grandparents on my dad's side, and my grandpa used to collect all the National Geographic videos, and what I saw something and started grab some pencil or colored pencils and start drawing on a paper and started paint start drawing some. Various types of animals, mostly African animals and Australian animals. And later on, I started drawing a bunch of dinosaurs. So after I've seen various media before, I started watching Jurassic Park back in the early 90s. Then afterwards, I then started drawing in superheroes after I watched them, or tried to rewatch it from the old superheroes store, superhero cartoons, and started collecting comics. And then from collecting the more I collect comics, I started to draw some various superheroes themes. And from there, started picking some different types of styles of drawing during the during my art academies.
Oh, you went to art academies, did you say?
Yeah, went to the art academy.
Okay, you want to explain that a little bit?
Sure. Then, in the beginning, I didn't know how to enter in the art academy in the Netherlands, and at first I thought, oh, just simply sign in the regular room. It's the same technique how I entered the school, but it didn't go that way. So for that, I simply found out that there's a preliminary art school in my home island. I said, you know what, let me just simply check it out. And after 9 months of building up my portfolio, then I started entering the art academy in the Netherlands. And okay, for 5 years, I get to know not only various techniques, but also get to know the broader sense of the history, the philosophical and and the theories and all the stuff that makes the artwork so dang unique. And afterwards, by 2017, I graduated.
So you got a degree in art?
In bachelor, yeah.
Bachelor's. Okay. Bachelor degree in art. Oh, awesome. Awesome. Mm-hmm. So you're probably more qualified than most of the people that are drawing comics nowadays.
Oh no, but some of these guys who draw comics are way better than the others, and I didn't say, simply boasted and say, yeah, I'm better than. There's no need for that, because every artist's style is just unique as the others, as like similar to a human DNA or the human fingerprint.
Yeah.
Each sense of style. I mean, if we expect that all artists that draw the same or make it artwork the same style, yeah, it won't be
boring. It'd be boring
indeed.
And the thing is, you can have someone that's qualified, you know, they've got a degree in art, means jack shit, mind my language. It really does, because art is in the eye of the beholder. Art is, what someone finds fantastic, other people might go disgusting. I mean, you look at modern artists like, her name was in my head a minute ago.
Frida Kahlo?
No. The one that did the Tracy Ullman? Is it Tracy Ullman?
I think so.
Tracy Ullman. Ullman? I don't know.
Tracy Ullman.
The one that did literally set up a thing in a gallery, and it was her messy bedroom. That's all. She had a degree in art. Mm-hmm. You know? And she earned a lot of money from it. I'd rather have a painting hanging on my wall. Of some flowers. Or something like that. Mm-hmm. I mean, I probably wouldn't have a painting of flowers on my wall, because I'm not really that. Not really. I like flowers in the garden. I like flowers in a vase. I'm not really into flowery patterns and stuff. So, but yeah. Absolutely. Art is in the eye of the beholder. And you can have all the qualifications you want. It doesn't mean you're talented.
And I guess Marco would like to hear what type of flowers you choose. I mean, could be any type of flower. Could be the either it's a tropical flowers or can be flowers from different regions. Maybe flowers in the UK would be nice.
Yeah, we got plenty of flowers from the UK. But no, I'm not gonna. But my point is, everyone's idea of art is different. And just because you have a qualification in art doesn't mean everyone's gonna like your art. And you can have
True
no
that.
qualification. You can have no qualifications in art and do some awesome work because you've never ever gone to an art college or university to study art doesn't mean you are not an artist. And I think everyone deep down is an artist in some way or other.
That's what Picasso said.
Oh, did he say?
Yeah,
Among
Picasso says every Picasso says, and if I'm not mistaken, he said everyone is born as an artist, but it depends how you grew up.
There you go. That does make sense.
Indeed.
Who is your favorite artist, or do you not have one?
I have various of favorite artists. Some of them I is either from the past or also from modern days. One of my when it comes to abstract, my favorite artist would be a Dutchman goes by the name Piet Mondrian. And in case you wonder, what's up with this guy? What's so famous about this fellow? As this guy, he's the guy who inspired the logo of Studio Line from Revlon, or
Oh
so
yeah. Awesome.
it's pretty unique.
Yeah.
I looked at it. This all happens when I look at my mom's hair stuff, hairs products. I looked one specific brand that it sees a blue, red and yellow blocks. I thought, hey, that's a really nice logo. Fast forward, this one specific painting from Piet Mondrian. Go, hey, I remember that logo. It's the same dude.
Oh, jeez. You're like, hang on, I've seen that before somewhere. Where was it? Oh, yeah, my mum's makeup bag.
From L'Oreal, if I'm not mistaken. Yes, from L'Oreal, the logo. And I looked at it and said, hey, that's a good logo. Fast forward, I look at the same painting. It's almost as if it's a deja vu. Go, what the fuck? Who? I need to know who made that artwork. Google enough, and turns out it's a Dutchman. Oh, that is so neat. That's
Awesome.
my favorite artist for abstract. When it comes to realism, that's a different story. All different types of artists are unique when it comes to realism. And the one I like the most could also be Norman Rockwell. That's one. That's a well-known artist from the States. But when it comes to in looking into the past, that would be either two well-known artists I know. One goes by the name of James Gurney. He's the guy who made the famous book called Dinotopia, and now he works in Scientific American magazine. Pretty neat, pretty unique artist. And there's another one, but goes from the UK. This guy, I've seen many different types of books when I was a kid, and in the local library in my home island, and I looked at those scroll through pages. That artwork goes by the name John Sibbick, and this lad made a one heck of a painting, and this painting was so unique. It looks as if it's a watching HD or 4K painting.
Awesome. Awesome.
For
Wow.
comics, it's a different story. Could be either from Marvel or DC. No matter, but the one when it comes to independence, I will simply say you might simply when it comes to sense of humor, I'll simply like the independent artist.
Yeah, there's a lot of independent artists that are really, really well, really good, do some good stuff. A lot that not so good, but working for a major company again doesn't make you the best.
True
Just
that.
means you got lucky.
Lucky or blessed, don't matter.
Yeah, lucky, blessed. Well, blessed and lucky are the same sort of thing. You got lucky that you got a job there, and I'm not saying it's because you get there's very few people that work for a comic company, and have the opportunity to work for a comic company. It doesn't necessarily mean they're the best at what they do. It just that they happen to be the right chosen. They happen to be chosen at that particular
Whatever
moment in time.
they see something, they brains fired up, say, "Hey, I like that." Asking another fellow, looked at it, go, "What do you think?" I don't know. There you go.
Exactly. Like I said, they're just, eye is in the art. No, art is in the eye of the
There you go.
beholder. Not art. Not eye is in the art of the beholder.
That's it. I is
No.
the I is the bewonder of the world.
I do wonder, but not around the world. I just wonder.
Who's your favorite artist, if I'm not mistaken? If
I
I ask.
honestly, I don't really know a lot of artists. I like styles, so I like Ruben and the Rubenesque style. Form, because to me it's reality. I don't like. I like. You'll often see, particularly in fashion and stuff, it's like very stick thing women, and I'm like, no. Most women are Rubenesque.
Oh, you mean like the artist of Paul Rubens, right? Paul Rubens.
See,
Yeah, I remember that this guy. He's a, if I'm not mistaken, this guy is from Belgium. And the funny part about this, one of my teachers explained it to me that this dude said, "What's wrong with this dude?" He told me this guy, he likes big rounded paintings. What do you mean by big rounded paintings? When I look at his paintings, I thought, "Oh, that's what he's talking about."
Chunky,
Basically,
chunky.
he likes him. He likes, if, let's just say, he love if he's in a modern times, hangs around one of the hip hop themes, he'll be continuing working forever.
He likes a
Catch my
big
drift?
donkey donk. He likes a big
Yes. Yeah.
donkey donk. No, I can't remember the name of the artist. Have you ever watched the movie Labyrinth?
Labyrinth. Was it the Labyrinth, if I'm not mistaken? What's not from the horror movies, right?
No, it's not horror. It's well, no, it's not horror. I don't know what
Oh,
fantasy.
and like what's the name of that guy again? Oh, David
David
Bowie.
Bowie. David Bowie, yeah.
David
So
Bowie, classic.
can you remember the film?
I haven't seen it, but I've seen some few shorts and few clips here and there, and especially the especially how David Bowie's hair the hairstyle and the makeup and all the whole.
So, but there's a scene in it where the stairs, where he's going up and down the stairs and he's hanging upside down and all that lot. I don't know if you remember the scene, but it always reminded me of a painting I'd seen as a kid, and I can't remember who the artist is. And it's a black and white painting.
Oh,
When you
those
look at it at different
stairs.
angles, the stairs are different ways, and they're always, it's really interesting painting, and I don't know who the artist is, but that I like things like that. Things that make you
It's
go, okay,
from
what's
MC
going
Escher. That's the
Yes,
name of the
that's
guy.
right. It is Escher. It is Escher. That's right.
An artwork called Relativity.
Yes. But yeah, I do like that's. I do like his work because he makes you. He makes you look and go. He makes you go, what's going on in this painting? You know, and a lot of his
It also
works
makes
like
you
that.
think.
He makes you think. Yes, he makes you think.
Keeps on going and going and thinking, try to figure out what's the solution of how it ends and all that. No, that's his artwork.
So, if I was to pick a favorite artist, it would be someone like Escher. Something that makes you go, oh, that's interesting. I'm not sure what it's about, but it's
You're not going to believe where this guy is from. MC
Would
Escher.
it oh, can go on, tell us where he's from.
He's a Dutch artist from the
Like
Netherlands.
I know. I thought he might be. I'm not going to say it, but the Holland produced some awesome artists. Awesome artists.
Yes. Whether it's in paintings or even in modern media, for example, a well-known director like Paul Verhoeven, this guy, he may be maybe he's from somewhere, but but this dude, he brought the sci-fi films in a very realistic, raw sense. Oh, what do you mean by raw? There's let's just say there's nudity involvement, there's a bloody gory scene. And swear words, there's always a swear word, cuss words in sci-fi films. And you think, in a sense, he brought this a sense of realism in science fiction films.
Well, yeah, I mean, why wouldn't you swear? If there's something scary coming towards you, you're gonna shout, fuck,
Exactly. Exactly.
You're not gonna go, gee whiz, what's that? Fuck, get out of
It's the same
here quick.
reaction when you imagine you need to go, you wake up in the middle of the night to go to the restroom or go to the bathroom, and you accidentally stomp your toe against either against the door or against the furniture. You didn't shout or go, "Oh Jesus, oh Lord!" No, you simply shouted, "Oh shit, you son of a
Absolutely. A big UFO coming down towards you, go, what the fuck is that? Not, oh, I wonder what that could be. No, it's what the fuck
No,
is that?
exactly. And when the alien pops up, the first reaction, the first contact will simply say, "What the fuck are you?" And the aliens will go, "Who the fuck am I? Who the fuck are you?"
And what did you say the name of that guy was? The director?
The artist, the director, Paul Verhoeven.
You're gonna have to send me how to spell type that out so I can look it up.
There are
Awesome.
hundreds of well-known artists who's dedicated for prehistory, for bring the prehistory, they call it paleo art.
Say that again.
The artists who make reconstructions of prehistoric life, they call it paleo art.
Oh, paleo art. Yes. I got you. Paleo art. Lots of people that are on a paleo diet now, you know. That's where I know the word paleo from. I'm on a paleo diet. What's that mean? I eat nothing but meat, basically. Isn't that awesome? Awesome. Them farts
That
going
reminds
to
also reminds me from that scene called I don't know if you remember, if you've seen that particular film called Step Brothers that was in 2008 about two crazy step brothers looking for a meaning of life and one particular scene they're both of them are looking for a job. Every time they look for a particular job, they simply made some mishap until one final job they find it of they're so close that they finally got the job, but then one of them just accidentally fart. It's such a long screaming fart that afterwards you go eh. And the interview and the boss asked him, "Was that fart?" The end, he said, "I could taste it on my tongue. It's
Oh,
onion
yeah.
ketchup." That
I can taste it. Oh. And now
was
because the funny thing is, when you talk about being able to taste a fart, you suddenly can taste a fart, you know? Your mind goes to that place. Even if there's no fart around you can now smell and taste a fart.
Yes. And I asked myself, how can you taste a fart? Unless you're a snake, that's a different story.
Oh, no.
Nah, I digress.
So we've talked about your art and your
Yes.
inf would you say any of these artists that we've talked about are influences on your own artwork?
Influence of my own artwork. For example, this art, my avatar, is actually from my. It started from my painting during the one of the preliminaries art, and I simply did some. First, I started simply painting on the paper. Grab. So I thought to myself, okay, let me put a handprint on my paper, and there you have it. But this one is the drawing version, color. It was colored in a colored pencil, and specifically what type of color pencil brand would that would be Crayola, and
Oh
with
wow,
that
not even expensive coloring pencils. No.
not at all. That's because I when I see those brands, for example, Crayola color pencil, my eyes popped up, goes wow. So many rich colorfuls here and there. And when I see something, I go, I want that. I want that so bad.
So you are really inspired by the bright, you like bright colors, so that will be Pierre that inspires you really, if because he was the bright colored
Yes.
artist, wasn't he? Yeah.
Bright
So
colors
you,
and natural structures. Biological, I mean organically structured. If
so
you look at that, for example,
it's combining the two. It's the bright colors of one artist and the realism of another artist that you combine to bring the art that you do today. Awesome.
You
Awesome.
see something and it fascinates you. It's the
Is
same thing
that
how we
a
take a scoop.
Is that a face in the middle of the hand on your avatar?
It's a handprint in reality.
Oh, okay. So it looks almost like a face in the middle.
It does. If you turn upside down or right side up or take a little bit of an educated guess or so, and you look at it, so yeah, that looks like a face. But in reality, it's just a handprint.
Just the way the handprint came out, that didn't hit the paint didn't hit the whole surface, if you like. Yeah. Awesome. Right.
And another style I do like also is the Aboriginal artwork.
Handprint.
Yeah.
The hand
Yes,
print,
the
yeah.
handprint, yes, the hand style.
Yeah.
It's an old form of signature. And
Yeah.
I asked myself, how the hell did they do that? So they go in one particular scene from National Geographic from 1982, if I'm not mistaken, yeah, 1982, called the Australia Aboriginals. And it takes place in the northern part of Australia in called a place called Kakadu National Park. And it was a scene of a father and son took to them the cave and figured out how to let the son to do the handprint style. Let's see how that goes. So first they did a little of conversation in their own language. I couldn't remember what I couldn't understood or so because hey, I've never been to Australia before. Maybe, who knows? And I thought, okay, let's see how that goes. First, they add some chalk and some water, mixing them well, and then place their hands against the wall, and I think they sip it and spit it out and left that mark. I thought, God dang, that looks simple, but it's pretty unique.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, the handprint, I think, has been used for a signature for before history, on most quite cave drawings all around the world, the handprint is a signature.
Yes.
Yeah.
Do that.
Because every handprint is unique.
There you go.
Or if your
Yes, it's
fingerprints
true.
are, your handprints are too. So, yeah. So I'm gonna bring this to a finale. And I normally ask one of two questions at the end of the show.
Okay.
So today I'm gonna ask you if you was stuck on a desert island, which three items would you choose to have with you?
If I'm in the middle of the island and the
You're stuck on a
object,
desert island, you're gonna be
yeah.
stuck there forever, no one around you, just you on this desert island. What three items would you choose to bring with you?
I would simply say a compass. Simple as a compass. I ask myself, why do I use a compass? I simply navigate where the heck am I supposed to go. And once I find a way of the location and all, you figured out, oh, there it is. That's where I'm supposed to go. And another part of the is simply figure out how to make a use of it. For example, put it those two sticks together, rub it to make their one big friction, and boom, you make a fire.
So
That's another.
a compass to find your way. What's your next item?
Next item is sticks and stones.
Well, there's
That's how I would have.
sticks and stones are there. You don't need to bring them with you. Something you bring into the island. What would you bring to the island?
So the compass and definitely I would simply my watch to know the
Watch.
time.
One more item.
One more item. At first, I thought about the good book, but that's a different type of story. I mean, I mean, if you're in the middle of a bad days, or it felt as if it's not going to happen, or so, I simply pick up a good book and read thoroughly. and
Good book's a good thing. Good book's a good
find a
thing.
good faith. Find a good faith. Doesn't matter what type of faith you could pick up, or either it's a this or that, but the one good question is this one: is that without faith, without belief, then what are we? That's a really good line from King Arthur from 2004.
Ah, but there's plenty of people that survive without faith.
Yeah.
You know? So, but yeah, like, okay, so you would take a compass, your watch, and the good book or a good book.
I don't want to say specifically which type of book, but it's up to the listeners to figure that out.
Okay. But what you're saying is a book of religion
A
rather
book
than
of
a book
faith,
of,
yeah.
yes, book of faith. Okay, cool. Fair enough. Awesome. Well, it's been great getting to know you, Q, Quinton, whichever
Yes,
lane you'd like to
thank
go
you.
by. And I hope the audience enjoy getting to know you too.
Indeed. Shout out at the shout out for the Madness Comic Network for the open draw stream. If you followed, which tell me what I mean, as they're all say and done, it's simply you can always find me, the Q Continuum, in the Madness Comic Network on
Awesome.
YouTube and Roku.
Thank you everyone for joining us.